and Bindmans. I'm going to welcome you here. I think there are going to be some stragglers, probably some of our speakers, but I think we should lay the start. Can I welcome you to the 10th UCL Bindmans debate, this one on TTIP. So we've already had an animated discussion about whether it should be called TTIP or TTIP, a presage to what might happen later on. Can I also welcome our guests, our guest speakers. I think Joshua is kind of going to introduce them, so I won't do that. Just to say that this event is being recorded, and so as well as the questions and answers at the end, so if you're shy for whatever reason, just bear that in mind. The fire exit there, and that's the nearest I can get to the administrative announcements. And the only other thing to say is I hope that you'll leave here informed, stimulated, and slightly smug. I say smug because leaving the tube the other day, I was given a leaflet by a very earnest campaign on TTIPs, and it was this, and he expected me to know nothing about it, but in readiness for this event, I learned a bit about it, and he was shocked even that I knew what TTIPs were. So I hope at the end of this debate you will be equally stimulated and smug, and I won't say whether the campaign was for or against TTIPs, I'll leave you with a neutral mind while our speakers try to persuade you one way or the other. Anyway, here's Joshua, please introduce them properly. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mike, and welcome. I'm very pleased to be introducing the 10th annual Bindmans and UCL debate. We're here to discuss what to call it, but I'm going to call it TTIP, but you can call it TTIP. It is, of course, the proposed Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership, TTIP, currently under negotiation between the European Union and the United States. Is it a modern-day Magna Carta, but for business, and where will it leave citizens' rights? That's what we're here to discuss. We have four speakers, I hope. We have certainly three so far, and we're hoping the fourth will arrive. On that assumption, each speaker will have no more than 15 minutes to outline their position. That should take us to just after 7 o'clock, and that will give us nearly an hour for discussion among the panel, questions from the audience. I promise to finish at 8 o'clock, when Bindmans will be inviting you to refreshments, so don't leave early. Here are our speakers. Jacqueline Miner is a lawyer by training and has spent most of her career working for the European Commission in Brussels. A little more than 2 years ago, she became the Commission's head of representation in the United Kingdom, effectively the EU's ambassador here in London. She is going to give us a quick introduction to TTIP and tell us what it's designed to achieve. I think she's also going to address what is called Investor-State Dispute Settlement, or ISDS, nothing to do with Ian Duncan Smith. You have to learn two sets of initials for the purposes of this debate, TTIP and ISDS, Investor-State Dispute Settlement. Next is Antonios Tsannakopoulos, who's Associate Professor of Public International Law at the University of Oxford. He'll be dealing particularly with the investment aspect of TTIP as well as dispute settlement. He may be comparing TTIP with the treaty that the EU has negotiated with Canada. That's called CETA, that's the third set of initials, Comprehensive Economic and Trade Agreement. The text of that is available, unlike the TTIP text, which hasn't yet been agreed. Ali Renison will be the third speaker if she arrives in time. She's head of Europe and Trade Policy at the Institute of Directors. She speaks for businesses on EU reform matters and helps to provide the link between business and government on increasing international trade. And she routinely provides advocacy for the Institute of Directors on regulatory issues in Brussels. She'll talk about the benefits as she sees them of TTIP for small and medium enterprises. And then finally, we shall have Nick Dearden, director of the campaign group Global Justice Now, which describes itself as a democratic social justice organization working as part of a global movement to challenge the powerful and create a more just and equal world. And who can be against that? His position is that TTIP allows multinational companies to undermine democracy and public services such as the National Health Service, and he thinks that the investor-state dispute settlement mechanism would allow corporations to override national laws and the protections they bring. Ladies and gentlemen, can I invite you to welcome our panel? Good. Jackie, over to you to begin, please.
Thank you, Joshua. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and I'd like to thank Bindmans for organising this event and inviting me to take part. I do suspect, Mike, that if you were given a leaflet, it probably wasn't a pro-TTIP one, because there are very few people campaigning on the streets in favour of TTIP. One has to acknowledge that, I think, at the start. Is TTIP a Magna Carta for businesses? No, I don't think. Certainly its proponents wouldn't want to compare it to Magna Carta. What it does offer, I think, is the potential for an enormously powerful trade and investment agreement, which will increase the freedom to export goods from either side of the Atlantic for mutual investment, and which will create opportunities for businesses and for consumers without impinging upon the rights of citizens. That's how the European Commission would frame its aspiration for TTIP. Let's be clear that this is an aspiration which is shared by all 28 member states of the European Union. Although the Commission negotiates TTIP, it does so on the basis of a mandate given to it by the heads of state and government of the member countries, all 28 countries. And so, currently, there is a unanimous agreement within the European Union at the highest level that this is an ambition which should be pursued. And it's part of a long-standing trade policy of the European Union. The European Union has always been in favour.
I think you can't hear very well at the back. I think it's perhaps best just to bring the microphone as possible.
Yeah. Is that better?
Thanks.
Keep talking and see what happens.
That's a dangerous council.
That is better, yeah.
Yeah? I feel as if I'm eating the microphone. So the European Union has always been in favour of multilateral trade policy. It's worked, for example, to try and bring some progress to the Doha round. But it's had to acknowledge that progress has been slow, it's been frustrating, and really not very existent. Hence, its decision to work on a number of bilateral trade arrangements, some of which have already been completed and are in place, such as the agreement with South Korea. Some have been signed but not yet ratified and are not yet in place, such as the agreement with Canada. And some are under negotiation, such as the TTIP. Why would the European Union choose to negotiate a comprehensive trade and investment agreement with the United States? Well, the United States is the European Union's main export market, and the US is third in rank of suppliers to the European Union. So there's already considerable trade passing across the Atlantic every day. In monthly terms, it's worth nearly 40 million euros a month. Who will benefit from the TTIP? Well, the economy overall. I think standard economic theory says liberalized trade enables growth, generates jobs, encourages competitiveness. And if you look, for example, at the South Korea free trade arrangement, European exports to South Korea increased by 35% in 3 years following the conclusion and the entry into force of that agreement. It's difficult to estimate the precise gains because we don't know what the shape of the final agreement will be. It hasn't been concluded, it hasn't been agreed, different parts of it are under active negotiation, other parts of it apart for the time being. I think Ali will talk about the benefit in particular to small and medium companies, businesses, but whereas big companies can overcome regulatory barriers by opening branches, establishing in the trading partner country, small businesses in particular don't have that facility. They can't open up a branch office in the US. They have difficulty, and we have done research on this, they have difficulty working out what exactly are the rules which apply to them, and they cannot afford the lawyers and the consultants to advise them on how to comply with an entirely different set of rules. So the smaller businesses in particular stand to gain from the TTIP. Some sectors are likely to do rather well out of the TTIP. Cars, textile and clothing, processed foods, and in many cases, particularly the food and the clothing sector, they are often comprised mainly of small businesses. These are the areas where there is still considerable tariff barriers to exports from the European Union to the US. And finally, employees, people who want a job. 30 million jobs in the European Union depend upon exports. And there is a rule of thumb which suggests that for every additional 1 billion euros worth of exports, we create 15,000 jobs. So the more we can export, the more jobs will be created. Now, that's not to say, it will be pointed out, I'm sure, by other members of this panel, that there won't be losers. When you open up markets to competition, as the European Union has done in the single market, there are winners, there are losers. And we will need to adapt strategies to address the potential losers in our member countries. But the TTIP does not represent some of the threats which it is alleged to do. It does not threaten European standards of food safety, of environmental protection, of health and safety generally, or of consumer protection. Commissioner Malmstrom, who is the member of the Commission responsible for negotiating TTIP, has made it very clear that we will continue to protect and maintain our cultural and societal preferences in terms of things like cloned animals, GMOs, the way we have a farm-to-fork approach to food safety. Secondly, it will not affect public services such as the National Health Service. Every free trade agreement and investment partnership into which the European Union has entered has excluded public services from its ambit. So it will not affect publicly funded education, it will not affect, in this country, the National Health Service or other utility services such as water. Both sides of the negotiating table have made consistent declarations to that effect. I know they're not always believed in this country and elsewhere, but more than restating the position, I'm not sure what more we can do. What will the TTIP comprise? It will comprise three pillars. The first is market access, a traditional area of trade negotiation. So you get rid of the existing tariffs and customs duties between the two parties. Generally, in relation to the US, they're quite low. On average, it's about 4% between the two parties, but they're still quite high in some areas, such as clothing. You also look at things like recognition of qualifications, allowing our architects, our lawyers, engineers to practice in the US. And finally, a big offensive interest, a big potential gain for the European Union is opening up public procurement, government buying and purchasing to European companies in the US. So that's the first pillar. Second pillar, and potentially the one that can give us much greater gains, is regulatory cooperation. So where we have a similar approach to the protection of a public interest, as we do, for example, in the safety of cars and motor vehicles, or in relation to medical devices and pharmaceuticals, we are aiming to have a form of mutual recognition of tests and inspections. Currently, if you want to put a new drug onto the market, you have to produce one set of evidence for the European Union and a different set of evidence, or the same evidence but in a different form, for the Food and Drugs Authority in the US. After that, both separate authorities will come and inspect your premises. It would be much less expensive for drug companies, producers of new medicines, if they could produce the same set of documents for both sides of the Atlantic. Similarly for car manufacturers. In the areas where we are far apart, as we are, for example, in food safety, in cosmetics, in chemicals. We are not going to change our legislation. The European Union is not going to align with the American approach. But even there are things that we can usefully do to cooperate. We can share knowledge, for example, of emerging threats. If our chemicals agency discovers that a particular chemical is being found to cause concerns for health or for safety or for the environment, we can usefully share that with the US. And the big gain in regulatory cooperation is that the TTIP is intended to be a dynamic agreement. So it's not a once and for all signed off and consigned to the archives of treaties. It will produce a cooperation for a platform for regulatory cooperation, which is intended, I think, to bring the parties together when they are considering new legislation and to consider how they might converge in their approach to such legislation. And I think we have to assume that convergence would be as likely to change the US approach as it might to change our approach. The final area of negotiation concerns trade rules. It concerns things like our rules on regulating competition, our environmental standards, our labour standards, and our consumer protection policy. I know time's short, so I won't go into that in detail. Finally, on ISDS, because I think most of this debate might, in the end, circulate around the question of ISDS. Investor state dispute settlement mechanisms are already in a number of bilateral investment treaties between individual member states of the European Union and the US. So they already exist. It's not a question of putting them into place for the first time. Not in the case of the UK, but in the case of a number of other member states. And mostly these are very old-fashioned ISDS clauses, which have rightly been subject to criticism. And you're going to hear some of that criticism from fellow panelists. The European Union recognizes that criticism, and the Commission indeed has put out the question of ISDS to extensive consultation, and it has recently produced a paper looking at ways in which existing ISDS clauses might be improved in order to make them more acceptable. But I think I should say at the outset that the entire TTIP agreement has to be approved by all member states, by the heads of government of all member states, by the European Parliament, and very probably by all 28 national parliaments. So the issue of ISDS, controversial, one has to accept, will in the end be subject to the scrutiny, the approval of national parliaments as well as the European Parliament. How can you improve ISDS? How can you reject some of the criticisms and accusations that are made of it? First of all, there is the concern that it impinges upon the regulatory freedoms of public authorities, that it exerts undue influence over the choices made by governments. Now, in the formulation we already have in the Canadian agreement, the CETA, but in also the formulation that is now being put on the table, it's being made very clear that the right to an investor of fair and equitable treatment does not prevent in any way public authorities taking measures which are based on public policy interests, health, consumer protection, environment, protection of labor, for example. That will not found a cause for action on the part of any investor. Okay. Secondly, forum shopping. There's been concern that large companies, tobacco companies, for example, chemical companies, alight upon any country which happens to have a bilateral investment treaty, they create a nameplate operation, and they then use that as a basis for suing a government. In the Commission's consultation document, that kind of thing will be stopped. Transparency will be enhanced. ISDF is often talked about as secret justice. Our proposal is that all the papers should be made available to the public, the dispute settlement should take place in public, there should be a standard panel of arbitrators. It's not up to the parties to select their arbitrators on an ad hoc basis. They should be subject to qualification requirements, ethical considerations. We also propose two more things, just to get to the end of ISDS. We also propose that there should be the possibility by the parties, i.e. the European Union and the US, to issue binding interpretations. It sort of trumps or gazumps the possibility of the dispute settlement. So before the arbitration takes place, the parties can say, actually, what we meant when we agreed to that term was this, and therefore the arbitration becomes redundant. There's a lot more in the consultation document. It is a consultation document. Discussions on ISDS have been suspended for the time being because the Commission wants to go back to the member states who in the end determine the course of the negotiation to see whether in the light of the concern that has been expressed, they want to maintain the instruction in the mandate to pursue ISDS or not.
Okay, Jacqueline, thank you very much indeed. So next is Antonios Tsantakopoulos, who is going to talk about investment. But I'd also like you, maybe, do you want to start with ISDS? Would that be convenient?
I'd rather not, actually, because we have to understand a few other things before we start
ISDS, if
possible at all. So thanks very much to UCL and Bindmans and to Colm and Mike for inviting me. The title of this is the TTIP a modern Magna Carta, but for businesses? Well, it is a modern Magna Carta, and the rest of it is redundant because, in fact, the Magna Carta was a very, very bad document which only protected the equivalent of big businesses at the time, which was nobility. In fact, you were supposed to be judged by a jury of your peers. That actually meant because you were a noble, you were supposed to be judged by nobles rather than by the commoners, right? And if you were a Jew, you couldn't charge interest. So I find the title after the Magna Carta bit redundant, and the answers are resounding yes. And now I'm going to tell you why. So listen carefully. So first of all, what is the TTIP? It is indeed a comprehensive free trade agreement, or preferential trade agreement, as it's sometimes called, with an investment chapter in it. And I'm going to focus on the investment chapter of the whole thing. So other than that, we don't really know what it is, because nobody has seen it.
Unless you have.
There are lots of documents about which tell you what it might be saying, or what the parties are saying it might say in the end. But you don't have a text, and I'm a lawyer, and without a text, I'm not alive. Because I'm a black letter lawyer, I should underline that. But we've seen other texts. In fact, we've seen the CETA, for example, which is the one that the EU has negotiated with Canada, but even worse than that, we've seen about 3,000 international investment agreements, whether bilateral or bilateral investment agreements or bilateral investment treaties, BITs as it's called, or BITs, and other chapters, investment chapters in various preferential trade agreements like the one in NAFTA. And we also have the Energy Charter Treaty. So we have quite a lot of texts, and the impressive thing about all these texts is that they are all very, very, very similar. So even though it is a network of bilateral or plurilateral relations, in reality they have a common core of standards. And in fact, they're almost like accession contracts. And at first, they've been negotiated like accession contracts. So if you try to go and negotiate with the US on a bilateral investment treaty, the US will show up with the US model bilateral investment treaty. And good luck negotiating that if you're Togo. You have my sympathy. So why are these things a problem, if they are a problem at all? Well, first of all, let's talk about their scope very quickly. What do they cover? They cover investments. What is an investment? Anything is an investment. Any asset with monetary value is an investment. You don't have to be making a contribution in most definitions of investment, that is. You don't even have to be making a contribution to the economy of the host state, the state that hosts you as a foreign investor. In fact, this has meant, and I'll give you some of the less egregious but telling examples, because I could get egregious, but I wouldn't want that. As a shareholder in a company, you can actually claim for reflective loss. Now, in international law, that is generally not allowed. It is through these investment agreements that we actually allow shareholders to claim for losses of the company. So you have the company, and then you may have investors or shareholders from a million nationalities, well, not a million, but 193 states in the UN, which can cooperate to figure out who's going to use the most comprehensive investment treaty to claim against the host state for whatever violation. Do you want another one? That's one very close to my heart. I'm Greek, as you may have realized from the long name. Recently, an investment tribunal, part of ISTS, has allowed Italian bondholders to sue Argentina for defaulting on its sovereign debt. Now, this is shocking, that you buying a bond could mean that you're actually an investor, which then can sue the state for declaring a sovereign default. The case is called Abaklat. It hasn't been decided yet, but it has been decided that the court, that the tribunal has jurisdiction. So I'm happy to talk about this in the discussion later. So if you then have an investment, what happens? You're an investor, and you are protected. How are you protected? You are protected by some ridiculously vague provisions. And when I say ridiculously vague, I do actually mean ridiculously vague. You heard one of them. It's another another little thing like TTIP or ISDS. It's called FET. That is the obligation of the state to give you fair and equitable treatment. Now, what the hell that might mean is as much your guess as it is mine. In fact, it has been interpreted to mean everything and anything, even the state charging you tax. Oh, that's unfair. Why? Because we didn't expect it. Okay. Do you want another one? Full protection and security. The state has the obligation to give you full protection and security. Right. And just try and figure it out a little bit in your head what these things might mean. For one, they're ridiculously vague. For another, they can be very, very stifling to regulation. For example, stabilization clauses included in such bilateral investment treaties. Very interesting. A stabilization clause says, I won't change my regulatory environment, otherwise known as I won't change my labor laws to, or my environmental laws to protect the environment more, because if I do so, and that somehow causes a loss to the investor, I've just violated my stabilization clause. And so I am liable. Indirect expropriation is also something that is where we've had a lot of discussion with respect to the regulatory powers of the state. That basically means, so you've heard earlier about, so for example, health laws and so on and so forth. When a US state banned MTBE, which is an additive in gasoline, because it was bad for health, effectively, it was promptly sued by Methanex, who was making MTBE, for expropriation. They said, you took away my rights. Currently, Australia is being sued by Philip Morris for expropriation of its IP rights, intellectual property rights, in putting forward health regulations with respect to plain packaging of cigarettes. These are just some examples. There are many more, and we can talk about them. Now, I'm not even going to go into non-discrimination provisions, which have been interpreted by tribunals very, very widely. And one example is Occidental versus Ecuador, which actually landed Ecuador with an award that was slightly larger than its GDP. But it's not quite right, but it was quite large. It was in the tune of $1.8 billion. It felt a bit like this movie with Austin Powers, right? $1 trillion, gazillion. You know, people in Ecuador listen to that and go, what is $1.8 billion? Now, the point that I want to make about all these very, very vague standards is that, well, they're vague, which means there's a lot of discretion in interpreting them. And who gets to interpret them? And here is where we come to investor-state dispute settlement. No, don't be. So I was just about to start on ISDS, so... I will be very, very, very brief. When you introduce very vague standards in law, effectively what you're doing is you're passing on a lot of discretion to the tribunal that interprets them. So what are the tribunals that will interpret these terms and that have been interpreting these terms? They are basically private tribunals where the process is started by the investor without the state coming in. In trade, it's not the same. In trade, it's state-to-state dispute settlement. So if effectively you are a private entity with some interest in this, you actually need to lobby your state to take up your claim. In investor-state dispute settlement, you, as an investor, independently of your state, you can go and sue the hell out of anyone you want if you want to claim that you've been unfairly and inequitably treated. And then it is up to them to determine what that means. And who is them? Them is basically arbitrators, international lawyers like me, only some of them slightly more evil. This is being recorded, isn't it? Man, I'm dead. Many of whom actually double as counsel, which is very interesting, how you can sit on a tribunal on one day interpreting fair and equitable treatment, and the next day representing an investor arguing that fair and equitable treatment should mean this. So that's, yeah, it's, yeah. Except Ecuador wasn't laughing. So you have that interest. But even if you are, and to be fair, some arbitrators do take the position that if I'm going to be an arbitrator, I'm only going to be an arbitrator, but they don't have to. They just take that position by themselves because they're nice, ethical people. Even then, they have a particular interest in being reappointed because that's how they make their living. And so if you want to be reappointed and you're customarily appointed by investors, then you might be friendly to investors. You just might, I'm not saying, you might take sides. On top of that, there is no review. There is no entity to review these decisions. There are some annulment proceedings in ICSID and some review by domestic courts, but they're on very, very limited grounds. You end up with, and basically no other entity or appeals process to streamline the whole thing. So basically you have private tribunals that exist for one dispute and one dispute only, and then go poof. Or to put it in slightly more legal terms, they are functus officio. Otherwise known as poof. There is no attempt at making these things consistent at all. And you can't attempt to make these things consistent at all. And the problem is now that we've had some shocking, and I truly mean shocking, decisions where tribunals interpreted the same provision, I'm talking about the same words. It's SGS versus Pakistan and SGS versus Philippines, for those of you who want to see it, which are basically two Swiss BITs with these two different states, where the two tribunals that were set up by two different investors to negotiate these two different treaties, which had the exact same umbrella clause, as we call it, came to completely different results. Do you want an even better one? CME and one of its shareholders, Lauder, sued the Czech Republic for what is effectively their annual health budget. Lauder lost on the basis of basically very, very similar provisions in the treaty. Lauder lost monumentally, but CME won monumentally.
3 minutes.
Yes, of course.
Yeah.
And in that sense, Lauder got his money through CME because, after all, he was a shareholder. So if you lose, you know, as a shareholder, just bring it through the company. And if you lose through that, just bring it through another shareholder. That will work. Now, there has been significant backlash against this. And the reason is because the history of these treaties is very clear. And their history is a history which is dipped in hegemony and imperialism. They were basically created by Western capital exporting states to to protect their investors in backward capital importing states, developing states, saying in the meantime that, of course, by doing this, we will teach you how to have a state based on the rule of law. We will import very important principles in your legal orders, and thus you will develop. And what you will develop into is a market economy. Now, some say, no, that's not the case at all, because look at all the south, south, north, north, and that means agreements between developed states, and TTIP is one of those. How can this be hegemonic? Well, it's hegemonic because this had never anything to do with developed and developing states at all. This has to do with private capital, and this is where the hegemony lies. So I'm happy to analyze that further in the discussion, but just to finish up, what is all this? Is it just me being a tree-hugging lefty? Yes, I am. So, no, it's not. And why is it not? Because it's not just Ecuador, Bolivia, and Venezuela who have withdrawn from ICSID, from the ICSID Convention, which is the International Center for the Settlement of Investment Disputes set up by the World Bank. It's not just that South Africa is terminating its treaties with European countries. It's also Australia no longer introducing ISDS provisions in its bilateral investment treaties. It is also Canada and the US changing their model bilateral investment treaties to reflect more space for regulatory autonomy. It is most importantly states even issuing authoritative interpretations of treaties, but not before the tribunal has decided, after the tribunal has decided, because the tribunal just went bonkers. And so effectively we are witnessing this backlash against both investment treaties and investment arbitration. There are some attempts to fix it, and you've heard some of those attempts. Now, we haven't seen the text, so I can't, it doesn't exist. There is no text. That's even more terrifying in some ways. And so there is no text, but there is also nothing outside of the text. Who said this, please? So with this, I thank you very much. I'm happy to discuss this later on.
Very good. Thank you very much. The next speaker is Ali Renison. You have 15 minutes. I know you're going to talk about the benefits for SMEs. If you're able to address some of Antonius's points, particularly about ISDS, his concern that Australia was sued by Philip Morris, for example. Philip Morris also sued Uruguay, Veolia sued Europe, Argentina was sued, and so on. So, you know, the concerns about ISDS, which is how the discussion is developing, if you can address some of those, that would be great. But otherwise, over to you, 15 minutes.
Apologies for being late. I should know after 7 years in this country never to get a cab between the hours of 5 and 7. And I'm back at my alma mater, actually. This is not the first time I've come back here to talk about TTIP, so I'm glad that there's quite a lot of engagement at UCL in it. I will come on to some of the points on ISDS. Something about like ISDS, I tend to like to leave this sort of conversational part of the discussion because I think it's just easier to come back on people's points. And also, to some extent, my interest and our organization's interest, I work for a cross-sectoral business group, which 85% of which are SMEs. We have an interest in ISDS, but it's very depressing to have it characterize the entire negotiations because it is a fraction of what is being discussed. It's obviously, according to public interest, a very important fraction, but it is certainly not our main huge overriding interest in the trade deal. But I will come on to some of the points that that were raised. I must spend a little bit of time, sort of what I call, and some might disagree, based on their point of view, myth-busting, because I think very often when it comes to trade policy, TTIP is really the first time that trade policy has been out and out on the sort of public spectrum and taking people or expressing that kind of interest in it, which I know people like Nick are very glad about and I'm very glad about. The downsides, as far as I'm concerned about that, are that there are, some of them are very, very complicated legal matters, and to try and explain and get the public interested in it sometimes gets watered down to simplistic reductionism. So I'm going to try and put some flesh on the bones of some of the more detailed stuff. So TTIP will put profits before people. What do we mean by people when it comes to their being deprioritized? The purpose of a trade agreement is to make it easier to trade with other countries. Invariably, more trade tends to lead to more enterprises doing businesses and selling products and services to other people, which invariably also means that people have jobs to create, because very often the statistical evidence has shown is that exports and business doing international trade are linked to much higher skilled workforces. And I know some may not agree, but to me, I think the broad consensus is that profit in and of itself is not a dirty word. Profit is what enables people to hire more people. What has not been proven, as far as I'm concerned, beyond a doubt, is that globalization and increased economic integration and trade has been a causational factor in increasing unemployment. I think you can actually make a probably much better case arguing that technological disruption and innovation has had a role in maybe sort of reducing traditional sector employment than globalization and trade integration. It also doesn't help that we tend to look at trade through a very black and white approach. So exports are good and imports are bad. Exports help businesses and you know, imports kill jobs. 40% of our members actually use imports to for value add in their own operations, and very often to re-export their products and services. And import competition, it increases the pool of choice available to consumers, and it's not just about cost, it's about having a wider sort of variety of products and services to choose from. So it's not a zero-sum game, as I think many people like to look at it. It's not an us versus them. It's if we export more, then you know, maybe their imports will kill jobs. That's not how it should be being framed. Debate. And I think very often the pro-trade advocates do a bad job of just looking at this through an export narrative. You know, when people are free to buy from and sell from and invest with each other as they choose, they can achieve far more than when governments are trying to sort of control their decisions. You know, people can buy the least or most expensive goods and services the world has to offer. They can sell to the most promising markets, and many businesses buy what they call component parts, so for re-exporting. And that's a very big thing with our members as well. I guess one of the questions that I'd pose to a lot of the critics of TTIP and free trade, generally speaking, is there seems to be a lot of consensus, rightly so, that we don't accept the premise that globalization in terms of labor mobility in and of itself puts a finitely and comprehensively downward negative pressure on wages and kills jobs, right? We all like to criticize parties like UKIP for propagating that narrative, and yet we don't apply the same narrative when it comes to products and services. We tend to think that actually there's more logic in terms of anecdotal evidence, very often not borne out by the statistical reality on a widespread scale, that increasing the flow of goods and services between countries is somehow going to kill people's jobs. And I think sometimes that question is not posed sufficiently. On ISDS, so I mean, there's a couple of, I know I came in late, there's a couple of things, places where I saw little holes in the argument. And there's a lot of criticism of ISDS, very rightly so. I think it always has to come back to, what is the counterfactual? Do you go from 60 to zero without actually trying to give the chance to reform ISDS? So a lot of the treaties that were used in terms of when you hear about Philip Morris in China, it was a very obscure, I think, 1980 investment treaty between Hong Kong and Australia that was used. And we're talking about very, very old treaties. The whole idea of as sort of treaties and trade policy progresses is you replace and you update those. And yes, we haven't seen the text, but for me, to preclude the outcome of those discussions about what can be reformed, can you create an appellate court mechanism, which we know the US isn't very keen on, but at least the EU is trying to put some steps forward in turning that into reality. So for me, it's just not going about from one extreme to the other. And I find it very interesting that people are so worried, the critics of ISDS are so worried on behalf of governments, when in fact the governments, at least in the context of TTIP, are the people who are insisting or insisted that they keep ISDS in there. Particularly, you may hear some noises from time to time about, oh, we're not sure if we want to the same extent or the model that's been used previously. But you know, the EU heads of government, they actually gave a mandate to the European Commission that said, we want ISDS in there. We reserve the right to look at what is the final outcome of that ISDS model. But you know, you talk about the Czech Republic. As far as I know, the case with the Czech Republic, as far as I know, the Czech Republic was actually one of the signatories to a group of countries who wrote to the Commission saying, under no circumstances do we want to see ISDS thrown out of the agreement. So it's very sort of nice to worry on behalf of governments that they're going to be sued, but the governments seem to be the people who want to keep it in there. And Also, I'm not sure actually that ISDS and bilateral investment treaties were set up just to sort of export our capitalistic model to countries. Very often it was about you were going into countries that had just opened up their markets for the first time, and there was a serious, I haven't heard, again I was late, the word expropriation come in, there was a serious risk of expropriating people's property, a company's property. That's what it was sort of designed for. So I think it might be a bit misleading to say this was all just about sort of hegemonic imperialism. So TTIP will erode standards is the argument I very often hear. It's understandable to some extent that that narrative has gotten traction because standards are being discussed in the context of the agreement. But not every standard is going to be harmonized. In fact, I don't think harmonization is probably the right word. I've heard some people talking about TTIP is going to be like, you know, creating the single market like you have in the European Union between the US and the EU. For the single market to happen, you have to have a central overriding authority, which is directing harmonization. That is absolutely not going to happen as a result of any regulatory cooperation element of TTIP. You know, what the US and the EU negotiators are doing is they are sitting down and they are looking at areas where you have regulations that you have the same effective outcome, and they're trying to say, well, if you have the same outcome, and where we're trying to get to is the same place, we want to streamline that, we want to consolidate it. But where the areas that there is complete separation, they're not going to do it. You know, despite what you may hear from the US would love to get the EU to change its rules and regulations around GMOs as a result of TTIP. And the Commission, I know we don't like to put our faith into sort of government and state actors that often, but the Commission is under such incredible pressure not to even touch that, that they've been very clear that that's not what's going to happen. Similarly, everyone here seems to think that we are going to be able to change the US's ban on importing haggis as a result of TTIP. And the US themselves, they have, it, to me it's inane, and you and I might actually, for all that we say that the US doesn't have particularly high standards, and the US tells us in Europe that we don't like to use their version of science. To me, the ban on sheep's lung is absolutely insane. There's no reason for it. It's really quite a cultural preference to my mind. But the US has said they're not going to actually have that change as a result of TTIP. So there are actually some, for lack of a better phrase, red lines that both sides have set down and said these are not what's going to happen as a result of TTIP. It's a shame that actually the places where you are talking about consolidating standards are in under unbelievably technical areas. I mean, one of the problems I find in debating and talking about TTIP is when you start to give the examples in vehicle testing and duty drawback, when you're trying to claim back duty for your product because you're going to re-export it, all this stuff, people's eyes just seem to glaze over. But I would say 90% of the stuff, this is what's being discussed in TTIP, and it's not very interesting because it's very boring, so to most people. Customs and trade facilitation is a lot of this is about reducing the cost for businesses where you find it possible. So you have, for example, something that's called a de minimis threshold, where after a certain amount, people who are exporting or importing goods have to pay the duties or the tariffs. And a lot of what we want to see as a result of TTIP is to try and raise that threshold so that small, this is about the supply chain, it's a lot about the supply chain, so that the people who are selling their goods, they don't have to pay as high a price, when they're trying to get their goods across the border. I don't know if we've touched on NHS and privatization. I'm sure Nick has a response for it, but we know that there is the standard public sector reservation clause in all EU free trade agreements that make it explicit that it's the preserve of national governments to organize their public services how they see fit. And I would love to hear of an example specifically, because I know that sometimes the ISDS issue is conflated with this. I would love to hear an example from previous investment state dispute settlement cases where ISDS has been used, an investor has sued a government for privatizing its or taking a service provision back into public ownership, because that's very often what is the counterfactual that is used in this case, that this is going to happen with the NHS. And I think you do start to get into talking about the NHS specifically, what I would call pigs might fly scenarios. Talking to our members, the US is naturally for them the place where they, in the first instance, think when they're going to export, they want to go and do business because we speak the same language, cultural proximity, etc. But a lot of these sort of divergence in, let's say, state regulations, public procurement market, will actually keep them from exporting to the US. So this is all about trying to make it cheaper to get your goods to market. I know the sort of the sexy issues are the ISDS and the NH privatization and GMOs, but honestly, 90% of that is not what's being discussed behind closed doors. Now, I think that people who are in favor of TTIP have no business trying to resist the call for transparency, because it's, I mean, for our members who are SMEs, very often they don't have time to spend lobbying the commission, etc. You know, and this idea that businesses get special access to the negotiations, I'm not sure what the special access is over NGOs. I send emails asking to meet with people in the commission the same way people do, you know, from the NGOs and the trade unions. And I've seen evidence, I've seen the photos, I know that the NGOs are able to meet with them the same way that we are. We have the same restrictions placed on us as anybody else who's trying to get access to any documents. We just don't have it.
3 minutes.
So, I mean, in the US does a much better job of that. One specific concrete example that I think sometimes isn't talked enough about is labor mobility. So we have a lot of members who... They export services to the U.S. They send, they recruit engineering staff, and they send them for site-specific projects to the U.S., which means that they have to be there for more than a couple of months. And one of the things that sounds very catchy, and I hope it catches on, is that's being discussed and mooted, is this idea of TTIP visas, to try and use TTIP as a way to make it easier for people who need to go over to the U.S. for specific projects to get them over there and to have professional recognition of professional qualifications as a result. These are some of the areas I think that aren't talked enough about TTIP, and they're very specific concrete examples, and yet it seems to be all the big ticket items like ISDS are dominating the discussion. So all I would leave you with is a plea to, when you're looking at the debate, read beyond the headlines, and it's very hard to read some of these texts. Even I deal in trade policy, but I really struggle with them some of the time. So don't believe everything that you read. You know, I think there's probably myth-busting that can go on both sides, but it's so important to actually look at the boring, dry, and technical stuff, because that's the bulk of what's being really, really discussed here. So.
Thank you very much. And finally, Nick Dearden. And Nick, I particularly want you to address the point that Ali made, that ISDS is designed to avoid people's property being appropriated. The argument is that just as international human rights law has empowered individuals, ISDS must safeguard the ability for investors who are otherwise subject to arbitrary state confiscations. And that may not happen everywhere, but that's the whole point of it. It's to protect people's investments, because if you don't protect people's investments, they simply won't invest. So that's a point I'd like you to pick up, but apart from that, it's over to you.
Thank you very much. Thanks for inviting me. So my contention is that TTIP, when you take it together with three other trade agreements that I'll briefly mention but won't dwell on, is the biggest corporate power grab that we've seen in at least 10 years, maybe 20 years. And that's quite a claim, so I'm going to spend 15 minutes explaining why I say that. But first of all, let me say, we're talking a lot about trade. None of these agreements are really trade agreements in the traditional sense of the word. They're not really about me selling you, you know, one good and you selling me another good. And don't just take my word for that. You can take the word of former US Secretary of the Treasury Larry Summers, who wrote in the Financial Times yesterday, and he said, "The era of agreements that achieve freer trade in the classical sense is over. What we call trade agreements are, in fact, deals on the protection of investment and on achieving regulatory harmonization and the establishment of standards in areas such as intellectual property. No reflexive presumption in favor of free trade should be used to further justify such agreements." That's someone who agrees with TTIP. So the idea that this is simply about selling more goods to each other is not what this is about. This is about investment protection. And all too often, who are investors? All too often, that means protecting the interests of big business, or protecting the interests of the financial sector, or protecting the interests of the super wealthy. And I would argue that TTIP is all about restructuring our society and restructuring the global economy even further in the interests of the super elite that many, many, many people in our society now accept are a major problem because of the levels of inequality that we're seeing all around us and how that's fueling climate change and so on. So I think TTIP can't be separated from the big problems that we're trying to deal with in the world today as human beings. And at the center of TTIP, we've already heard, is this regulatory harmonization. Now, regulatory harmonization sounds very nice. We all have... The theory is, as you've heard, countries all have different sets of regulations, and it makes it more expensive to do business and to trade goods and so on, and it makes it difficult to invest. So isn't it a sensible thing if we try and harmonise and make these standards as similar to one another as we can? Well, again, I'm not going to answer that. I'm going to allow Joseph Stiglitz, the very famous economist, to answer that for me. He's written in the New York Times, "Huge multinational corporations complain that inconsistent regulations make business costly. But most of the regulations, even if they're imperfect, are there for a reason, to protect workers, consumers, the economy, and the environment. What's more, these regulations were often put in place by governments responding to the democratic demands of their citizens." In other words, what's a trade obstacle to one person is to another person an important piece of environmental regulation or labour law or public service provision. And I'm deeply concerned that we're talking here about a treaty which is trying to reconceptualize the whole of our world as a gigantic marketplace and everything in it as a commodity. There are more important things, actually, than somebody's profit. There are more important things than whether something's a trade obstacle or not. And the desire of this treaty to turn everything into a commodity to be traded, I think is deeply worrying to our society, to what we've become as a society. Under TTIP, the proposal is that as much as possible we make standards consistent. And some people have argued, well, that might mean higher standards. That sounds good. But I would just express the suspicion of Zach Goldsmith, the Conservative MP, who told Parliament last year it's very difficult to imagine any standards going up as a result of this agreement. And that's what we hear time and time and time again from critics. Not just critics on the left, but critics across the spectrum of this deal. We're talking here about really important aspects of public policy. We're not talking about tariffs and quotas and trading off one against another. We're talking about, do we have the right as citizens to make decisions about regulations in our own society? Now, we can have an argue about all sorts of things, food standards and chemicals and whatever, and we can argue whether they're in or out, and unfortunately none of us know because the negotiations are taking place in secret. It is worth saying there are very significant differences in our regulatory standards in certain areas like food production, which is why people have focused on food production, you know, the amount of chemicals, hormones and antibiotics you pump into cows. We have a very, very different system here in the European Union. We have a very different system with regards to genetic modification. Actually, food production and food quality standards are one of the great successes of the European Union. So I think it's understandable that people are concerned about those standards. But it's not all one way. America has better standards of banking that were brought in after the financial crash by President Obama. We know that banks in the City of London are desperate to undermine the Frank Dodd Act. They're desperate to do that, and they see TTIP as one way of doing that. Big Pharma as well. Look at pharmaceutical companies, massive powers to advertise and aggressively push their products in the US. We don't have that in the EU. So there are lots of differences in standards, and I don't think it's a coincidence that the biggest pushers for TTIP, the biggest business pushers, are agribusiness lobby, pharmaceutical lobby, and the financial lobby. The financial lobby is so keen on the European Union Commission's negotiating position that it says it could have come out of one of our brochures. So there is a very clear synergy of interest between what the administrations on both sides of the Atlantic are arguing for and what business is arguing for. And indeed, the European Union has pushed a particularly frightening new mechanism as a result of this regulatory harmonization that's being discussed, that's called a Regulatory Cooperation Council. We know about this thanks to WikiLeaks, by the way, otherwise we wouldn't know. But the Regulatory Cooperation Council is all about giving stakeholders in Brussels and Washington, and for stakeholders, read big business, if you know how many business lobbyists there are in Brussels and Washington, guaranteed power to influence regulatory processes. They get a guaranteed role in regulatory processes. This is really frightening, and regulators have a duty to consider the impact of regulations on trade and investment, climate. So when they're considering a piece of environmental legislation, they have to put on their TTIP glasses and say, well, actually, does this comply to the world being a gigantic marketplace and everyone being able to sell what they want, when they want, on the terms they want? So it's a really frightening change in the mentality that we've already got too much of and will be further embedded by TTIP. Now, there's more I can say about aspects of TTIP. I can talk about the energy chapter, which the European Union is pushing, which wants to create a free market in energy resources. That will definitely mean more fracked gas and more tar sands oil coming into Europe, thus boosting the production of those toxic and unsustainable fossil fuels. I could talk about the local procurement agreement, it's already been mentioned actually, which aims at wrenching open US local government purchasing, making it harder for American states to use taxpayers' money to source locally and use their tax spending power to create jobs in local areas. I think it's perfectly reasonable. I don't think we should have given it up in Europe. I could talk about the services chapter, and Ali wants an example, and I've got a couple of examples of ISDS being used to prevent governments or to sue governments for taking back public services into national ownership. One is Slovakia taking back national health insurance into public ownership. It was sued successfully for that. Another one is Argentina, which was successfully sued a few weeks ago for taking water in Buenos Aires back into public ownership. Why? Because they told the water company, do not put up prices in the middle of an economic crisis, which has thrust millions of people into poverty. The water company said, too bad, and they said, well, we're going to nationalize you then. Argentina now faces a $400 million bill for that, for taking what is a perfectly reasonable public policy stance towards that water company. I could talk about all of this, but I am going to talk, and I could talk about jobs as well, by the way. And I think the idea that jobs and growth necessarily will flow from TTIP, even by the European Union's own predictions, are extremely suspicious. But I'll come back at the very end to that. But essentially, the thing that absolutely has been driving the debate is this ISDS, these ISDS cases. And it's an area where really you can't say we're just scaremongering, precisely because these things already exist in so many other treaties. What TTIP would do, and the other treaties we're talking about, is massively extend the scope of these mechanisms to tens of thousands of other companies in the US and the European Union. And I mean, you're probably bored to the back teeth by now of the examples, but I'm going to give you a couple more anyway. Canada was successfully sued just a few weeks ago because it made a judgment to halt a 150-acre basalt quarry in Nova Scotia, which happens to be a key breeding area for endangered species, after they conducted an environmental review of that project and found it clashed with core community values. They were found against, they're now facing a settlement of $300 million for taking a perfectly reasonable public policy decision. Again, I've talked about Slovakia, I've talked about the Argentina case. Canada was found against in a similar arbitration for trying to ban a toxic chemical in petroleum. Actually had to reverse the decision in the end to avoid the penalty. Hamburg, same thing, was found guilty many years ago in one of these arbitrations for trying to impose higher environmental standards on a coal-fired power station, had to reverse the decision. So there are many of these which show that it's not just about money changing hands. Actually, this has a direct effect on public policy, on what governments are prepared to do. And there's an arbitration lawyer who's come out recently and said, I get governments coming to me all the time worried about whether certain public policy decisions will fall foul of these tribunals. And that changes the way they approach public policy. Who do they become accountable for? And I'll quote on The Economist for this one. I don't often quote from The Economist, but they did quite a nice editorial on this. And they said, if you wanted to convince the public that international trade agreements are a way to let multinational companies get rich at the expense of ordinary people, this is what you do. Give foreign firms a special right to apply to a secretive tribunal of highly paid corporate lawyers for compensation whenever a government passes a law to, say, discourage smoking, protect the environment, or prevent a nuclear catastrophe. Yet that's precisely what thousands of trade and investment treaties over the past half century have done. I think, coming from The Economist, that is a really impressive statement that's been joined by a number of free market think tanks around the world, actually. And when we hear about the European Union modifying and amending their position, well, the consultation that you heard talked about had 150,000 responses to it. That's a record-breaking number of responses for a European consultation. 97% of them said, we do not want ISDS. So why this is still being talked about by the European Commission, I have no idea, because as far as I see it, there is no mandate from the public to discuss this in TTIP. Now, we've talked a little bit about secrecy. Quite right, as a result of campaigning, some documents have come to light, but I'll just quote from one MEP what she told The Guardian a few months ago. As an MEP, I've now been granted privileged access to the European Parliament's restricted reading room to explore documents relating to the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership deal. But before I had the right to see such top secret documents, which are restricted from the gaze of most citizens, I was required to sign a document of 14 pages reminding me of the dangers of espionage, and crucially, that I had no right to share the contents with those I represent. Molly Scott-Cato, who is the MEP, was also told she couldn't take a phone or pen in, she was accompanied by a guard at all time, and had to view the documents in chronological order. That's an MEP, so heaven help the rest of us if we want to know what's going on. And as I say, if it wasn't for WikiLeaks or some of the information that's come from the mouths of the negotiators or big business lobbyists themselves, we would have very little idea. But fortunately, we do have some idea of what's on the agenda as a result of that. Now, TTIP, and I'm not going to go through this in great detail, but TTIP is only one, as I said, of four agreements at the moment, four big agreements. There's one between the between Canada and the European Union. There's one between the US, Japan, and a number of Pacific countries called the Trans-Pacific Partnership. This is very big in the US at the moment, big discussions going on around it. And there's one called TISA, which is Trade and Services Agreement, which is a kind of super-liberalization agreement for public services. And taken together, these agreements are all about rewriting the rules around investment and around investor protection. I mean, I think investor rights, I think it's actually these are according a degree of rights to investors that aren't available to ordinary citizens. That, I mean, we talk about human rights, and this is simply giving, I mean, I don't accept that corporations and investors have the same rights as human beings, but unfortunately, they actually have more rights under ISDS, because human beings have no access to international justice if they're abused by a corporation. In fact, our government, the UK government, regularly vetoes the setting up of any such legal system when it's brought up at the UN by Ecuador, Bolivia, and Venezuela on an annual basis. So this is about a gold standard of new rules. But we can stop it. So more than 2 million people have signed onto an EU-wide petition. That's a record breaker. Last week, even Obama's personal intervention in Congress didn't allow him to gain get a special vote passed, which would have given him special authority to negotiate a trade agreement. Last week, also, the European Parliament couldn't come up with an agreement on its position. That's a sign of how deep tensions go and how much the campaign is growing. And I want to just end by quoting from two people. First of all, Jeffrey Sachs. Again, not someone I always agree with, but he's solidly against TTIP and TPP. And he says, the kind of globalization that we have right now, which in some ways expands the pie, does so at a very high cost to the poor, to rising inequality, to more frequent financial crises, and to a growing environmental catastrophe. Nothing that I know of these two treaties would do anything but continue us along that course. That's Jeffrey Sachs. Joseph Stiglitz, agreements like the TPP and TTIP have contributed in important ways to inequality. Corporations may profit, and it's even possible, though far from assured, that gross domestic product, as conventionally measured, will increase as a result of these treaties. But the well-being of ordinary citizens is likely to take a hit. Trickle-down economics is a myth. Enriching corporations, as the TPP and TTIP would do, will not necessarily help those in the middle, let alone those at the bottom. I'm not arguing that these treaties might increase growth. What I'm arguing about is that the negative and detrimental impacts of these treaties go right to the heart of the major crises we face as human beings at the moment. And we need to get these treaties off the table and actually start talking about how we trade with each other in a way that makes the world more equal and more sustainable.
Thank you very much. Now, before I take questions from the audience, I'm going to take some comments from the panel. And I'm, in particular, I'm going to start with Jacqueline Miner, who's, as you've heard, the EU Commission's head of representation here in the UK. And I want to talk quite briefly about some of the points that have been raised by the other speakers and put these to you. Let's start with Nick's general point. This isn't quite how he put it, but he says this is all about making rich people richer and taking away protection from ordinary people that they have under various regulations and so on. So the general point.
On the general...
Just speak close to the microphone. Speak close to it.
On the general point, I don't think so. I disagree. And the Commission would disagree, and 28 governments would disagree. Nick talked a lot about the European Commission doing this, the European Commission doing that. This is not an invention of faceless bureaucrats. This is the expressed ambition of 28 democratically elected governments who are responsive to their electorates. So it's not Fonctionnaire in Brussels dreaming this up. Let me quote somebody, because Nick was fond of quotations. Richard Paxman, you won't have heard of him, no relation to Jeremy as far as I know. He is the chief executive of a small company in Yorkshire who produce a scalp cooling device that helps prevent hair loss for people undergoing chemotherapy. A major barrier to the US is the regulatory pathway. We are an innovative SME with a European-approved class 2A medical device, which I happen to know about because I used to do medical devices in Brussels. And we are required to carry out a full pre-market approval by the Food and Drugs Authority. If the US was prepared to say, and I know because I've spoken to the US about medical device regulation at length, basically we have the same safety standards, in fact theirs are probably slightly higher than ours, they're more rigorous in their inspections. If the US were prepared to say, well, we take the authorization to put this on the market in the European Union, and we accept that that's been subject to a rigorous examination, you have access to our market, that would benefit not only the people employed by that company, but the potential users of the device. So it's not simply big business who will benefit from this.
Okay, let's talk about ISDS, because I think, you know, anybody coming into this argument from outside may be a little confused by it. You have said that the particulars of the aspect of dispute settlement are up for discussion, up for renegotiation, but it's implicit in what you say that there has to be this way in which countries can be taken to arbitration by corporations if Nick is right, they do things like taking public services that were privatized back into public ownership. And people are concerned about the National Health Service. They are concerned that this gives powerful corporations too much power over individuals, too much power to sue governments to the detriment of individual citizens.
Yes, and I understand that concern. And as Nick has said, it has been expressed. Was expressed in the consultation, it's been expressed through this petition. But I would make a number of points. First of all, criticizing ISDS provisions based on lived experience is a bit like criticizing a Model T Ford or a 1950s Chevy for not meeting modern emission standards. Most of the examples that you've heard are based on very old type of ISDS clause, which has been rightly criticized, which the Commission has looked at in great detail, and which it has said in a publicly available document it would seek to change in a number of ways. I mean, we can go through this. First of all, fair and equitable treatment. What is that? I think Antonius said it's your guess as much as mine as to what that means. Lawyers learn from experience. If a concept is vague, imprecise, open to paradoxical interpretation, they tie it down in the next round of drafting. And that's precisely what we're doing in relation to fair and equitable treatment. It will mean, for example, that the European Union or the US retains its regulatory discretion and its power to change its rules in ways that it considers necessary to protect human health, the environment, employees, etc. Locus standi. Yeah, we're conscious that there is forum shopping. We're going to put in, if we go ahead with the ISDS clause, provisions which will stop forum shopping. Arbitrators. Antonius said you can be an arbitrator one day and you can be pleading the next. That would be stopped in accordance with the proposals put forward by the Commission. There would be a standard panel, rather like a judicial bench, from which arbitrators would be chosen not by the parties to the dispute, but by the European Union and the US authorities.
Okay, let me ask you about negotiations, because as Nick said, they ran into difficulties at the European Parliament last week. The Parliament postponed a vote to endorse the position. It suggested the vote could be delayed until September. Then that means that TTIP negotiations might not be concluded this year. Nick said there were problems in the United States. Some people who feel that for this to work, it has to be done while Obama remains president. What is the timescale, and is it going to be presented? I mean, we've talked about the secrecy over negotiations. Well, you can see the point about that, because while negotiations are going along, it's difficult to do those in public. But are we going to be presented with a fait accompli? Are we going to be just given a final draft and be told that's it, all the governments have agreed this, take it or leave it? And how much time will there be for discussion, and when will we get to that stage?
Ooh. right, so the target for conclusion of the agreement is still the end of this year. It has to be said that that is somewhat dependent upon the US side getting this fast-track agreement, which they very much want, not particularly because of TTIP, but because they want to conclude the Trans-Pacific Agreement very swiftly. And a single authorization would cover both agreements. So there's still a lot of intensive work going on in terms of negotiation. On the European Parliament, I think their failure to, their decision to defer the vote on a resolution indicates that there is a division of opinion in the European Parliament. There's a division of opinion, particularly in the socialist group, which made it difficult to see any clear outcome. On transparency, people do not negotiate agreements in public. And international treaties, since the Treaty of Vienna, have not been negotiated with an audience. They've been negotiated behind closed doors.
The WTO.
Sorry?
WTO.
All the texts are online with comments. You know exactly who's put in what text.
And we have put in, all of the EU negotiating texts online when they are finalised by the member states. We have also put online all of our
actually for CETA, it was just leaked. It was months before the European Union put it online, if it has it online. It was just leaked for CETA, yes.
Yeah,
the negotiating
I'm talking about TTIP. I thought we were talking about TTIP.
Is there a negotiating text for TTIP?
Yeah, there are negotiating texts.
They're not negotiating texts. Yeah. They're position papers.
They're position
papers. It's nothing like the negotiating texts at the WTO.
There are position papers which set our objectives in particular sectors, and there are negotiating texts. When you're negotiating with a partner, you have to a degree, respect that partner's position. And part of our difficulty on the European Union side is that the US is unwilling to agree to the same degree of transparency that we already offer. So we can't put the US texts online, for example. We can't share them with MEPs. But we have gone as far as we can, and we're trying to go further. We're still negotiating with the US to be able to be more open with our stakeholders and with the European Parliament. And the final point, which I think I started with, this is not going to be presented as a fait accompli. It has to be approved by the member states. Okay, 28 ministers may be sitting in a closed room in Brussels, also by the European Parliament, certainly by the European Parliament, which is, like all parliaments, open and public. And very probably, it would depend upon the text and the content of the agreement, by the 28 national parliaments of the member states.
Okay, I think I will open it to questions from the floor now. Gentlemen, if you want to give your name over there, please. Microphone's coming around.
Thank you. Stephen Fieta from Volterra. Fieta, I am a humble counsel involved in these types of matters. I'm going to speak about ISDS, and I work both for governments in some cases, I'm a former government lawyer in fact, and for investors in others. And I just want to address, well, first of all, thank you to Bindmans and to UCL for putting on such an interesting debate, and thank you to the panelists who have raised a number of quite legitimate points of debate in relation to TTIP. But I want to address just a few issues which I think are possibly rightly classified as false mantras in this discussion, just to ensure that it is as balanced as possible. The first one relates to the point of who benefits from ISDS? Who are these rights accorded to? And the point has been made, among others, by The Economist, I think, that this is about rich people becoming richer. Well, Professor Zanakopoulos indicated, there are something like 3,000 investment agreements in force around the world already, and I've yet to see any definition of an investor in it which talks about any minimum threshold of net worth or wealth. Any investor who invests his, her, or its capital in another country is an investor, essentially, for the purposes of most or all of those treaties, and that explicitly includes individuals alongside corporations. And many cases have been brought by individuals against big governments to protect their investments. Secondly, what is an investment? What types of asset are protected? The point was made that this concept of investment essentially encompasses anything. Well, that's not the case in the jurisprudence of 500 plus awards in these disputes, which show very clearly that many tribunals look very closely at whether a claim has been brought on the basis of a legitimate investment, and a very large number, a large proportion of claims have been thrown out summarily on the basis that there was no investment at issue in the case. So tribunals do consider whether there has been an investment, whether there has been a contribution in order for a particular threshold to be met. The third issue relates to the rights that are protected, the substantive rights. What are they? Well, the core rights that are protected in these treaties have not come out of nowhere. They are very old rights, and they are based in public international law and customary international law. They exist regardless of these treaties. The right, for example, for a foreigner not to have his or her property taken without compensation by the government. That is a customary international law rule, and that is at the heart of the expropriation standard in these treaties. These treaties, it is commonly accepted, acknowledge states' rights to take property. States can take anything they like in the exercise of their sovereign powers. All they require is a payment of compensation to the owner in order to make it whole, sometimes equating to market value, sometimes equating to something else. Fair value is a term often used. Similarly, fair and equitable treatment is a customary standard.
I'll get you to your last point, and then I'm going to get Antonius to respond.
Sure. My last point. Well, let me skip my fourth mantra, which related to the people considering these claims, such as Professor Philippe Sands of UCL, who I think would not classify himself. He's many things. He's a leading and fantastic international lawyer, but probably not a moonlighting corporate lawyer, as The Economist puts it. My final point is, ultimately, I think this is an issue of the rule of law. The question is, should there be a basis on which these core rights, such as the right not to have one's property taken without compensation, should be able to be arbitrated or heard in some independent forum or not? The EU and the US can take the approach of Venezuela, which is that it can withdraw from these treaties and prevent investors from a forum from recovering compensation for takings, or it cannot. There can be a legitimate debate about what the substantive standards are, for sure. But these core standards of customary international law, I would say, are better protected and better served by having some form of dispute settlement, including in these treaties.
Okay, thank you, Antonius.
Thank you very much, and thanks to Stephen for, lowering up on me. I'll start with your last point, Stephen, because I have many points to answer, and I don't know if I'll have time to answer them all. The rule of law means absolutely nothing. The rule of law can be the rule of good law, or it can be the rule of bad law. And in and of itself, it is a moral emptiness, because the rule of Nazi law is also the rule of law. I'm not saying that investment law is Nazi law in any way. I am just saying that just invoking the rule of law and
treating it as something that is necessarily good just won't find me agreeing with it. Now, you say very rightly that there are all these rights didn't come out of nowhere. Some of them sort of came out of nowhere because fair and equitable treatment used to be known as the minimum standard of treatment and used to have a content, but then when it was put in those treaties and then adjudicated by tribunals, all of a sudden it opened up, boom, and everything came in it, to the extent that the NAFTA treaty parties had to come in and issue an authoritative interpretation tying it up specifically to the customary standard of treatment. Having said all that, I would make the same point to Ali earlier, which said, oh, these treaties were done just to protect from expropriation. But there is protection from expropriation in customary international law. You didn't have to write it in a treaty.
But there's
finish this. So it connects with the dispute settlement process in this. Now, I very much agree with Stephen, perhaps, and especially when you establish rights and obligations in international law, it is always best to have a dispute settlement system for dealing with them. One very important question is what kind of dispute settlement system? And whether this is the correct type of dispute settlement system or not a very good type of dispute settlement system is a debate that has been raging between international lawyers for a very long time. So and obviously this was not an overly legal talk, obviously because it is for a general audience. But if I can be allowed to just pick up a couple of points. We heard both Jacqueline and Ali refer to obscure old treaties. For international lawyers, there's nothing obscure, and Stephen can confirm that since he's here. There's nothing obscure about these treaties at all. This is, in fact, the bread and butter. Sorry?
Yeah, what is the relevance to TTIP?
They're not the model for TTIP for one reason and one reason alone, and that is because of the backlash that they have created. And the backlash, in part, is being driven by the people who had to suffer from these things. And if you look at CETA, you will see that the text of CETA is not that significantly different. There are improvements in the margins, which show that the backlash is actually paying off. But unless the backlash continues, and this has to do, and I'm not speaking as a lawyer now, I'm speaking on the, and I don't pretend to be. This is a clear political decision that you need to take. Because as lawyers, we can sit down and discuss for as long as you want what exactly it means, fair and equitable treatment, and so on and so forth. Well, but when it comes to this, you have to take a political position. And the political position can be on either side of the debate. So as far as I'm concerned, not my lawyer's opinion, just my citizen's opinion, is that these things give way too much power to the corporations. We've heard a lot about states wanting ISDS there, big surprise, because I was living in my little, a pink cloud, which said that the states protect the people rather than the private capital. I mean, big surprise that the Czech Republic actually wants ISDS in there. Who knows to what extent they're being pushed and by whom. And as for the European Union's respect for democracy, please don't get me started. I am okay. Greek, and I've had a very, very rough 6 months.
Okay, I won't get you started. I will bring in, who knows what's happening in Greece as we speak. So I'll bring in Ali at this point to respond to these points.
Yeah, I want to make it brief because I like sort of engaging in conversational style. I mean, I'm not sure sort of which parts of international law you claim there's this natural recourse to against discrimination. There is no guarantee with the US, unless it is by way of a bilateral investment treaty, that you can ensure non-discrimination. So what is it that you have recourse to from the US's point, if from an investor going into the US's point of view that you rely on, that is not provided by...
You claim diplomatic protection from your state under customary international law. Your state takes up your claim and brings it against the other state that has heard... That is state-to-state resolution. That's about filtering things through the state, yes, rather than giving it to the corporation. And this is a political position. You can either say, I want the corporations to have that, or you can say, I would like this to go through the filter of the state. There is no legal solution to this. It's just we are on different sides of the political spectrum, so you won't convince me that it's okay to go with the corporation.
All right, let's go to another question. There's a gentleman over there in the white shirt. The microphone is coming in your direction, and let's see if we can move the discussion on.
Thank you. Can you hear me?
Yeah, go ahead. Do you want to give your name and...
Max Schofield. I'm hoping to go to the bar next year. I've got a question for Antonius, really. Regarding the arbitrators sitting as arbitrators at counsel, in England we have barristers who sit as masters and as judges and as barristers the next day. It's been going on for a long time, and I think it works fairly well, just as we have arbitrators who will arbitrate one day and be advocates the next day. I think that your presumption of bias and your presumption of partiality is a fairly poor perspective to take with regards to the law. I think that you can't just assume there's going to that all lawyers are going to be sort of clandestine, nefarious people. I think that it can work. And secondly, I would say that we're living in a globalized economy, or the economy is certainly moving towards globalization. Why should we be so fearful of a lex mercatoria that is independent and run for this new globalized market? The WTO and the GATT obviously haven't been as effective as we wanted them to be. Why not have a new instrument which can work to use the EU parliaments as a living instrument and develop forward for the globalized economy?
Okay, Antonius, so two questions. Why are arbitrators biased, and why should we be afraid of a new legal order?
I did not say they are biased, and those of you who understood, I mean, I may not have said it properly, and thus I have been misunderstood. I just said that there is cause for suspicion when somebody one day argues that FET has this content, and on the other day is sitting there as a judge of what FET or FET or fair and equitable treatment means. Now, if you can make the difference between that and saying all arbitrators are biased, in fact, what I did say is that there are certain arbitrators who have made an ethical decision without having being obliged to do so to only act as arbitrators. And on the other side, there have been counsel that have taken, again, an ethical decision to say, I will only be counsel in those cases and not sit as an arbitrator. Beyond that, if you look at the European Convention of Human Rights, you will simply see why it is wrong, because there is something called independence and something called impartiality. And in fact, impartiality has to be both objective and subjective. And so the fact that something causes or is cause for suspicion under the European Convention of Human Rights, for example, would mean that you need to recuse yourself. There have been many attempts, indeed, by states to eject arbitrators who are perceived as biased. In fact, I've heard with my own ears a particular arbitrator, and I'm not going to name him, saying, this is what I do. I have 4 houses. How many have you got? I have none, in fact. And perhaps it's just because I'm jealous. But the fact remains that this person quite openly went out and said, look, I'm an investor-appointed guy. What do you expect me to say? And in fact, we don't expect him to say much different. There are some egregious decisions in that sense. That is not generalizable. I'm not saying this is what happens across the board. I'm saying this does happen, and it is cause for concern. That point, and I think everybody accepts that. I don't think anybody doesn't accept that. I think Jacqueline said quite clearly that the EU is working to deal with this particular thing. Whether they will be successful or not is a different question. And indeed, international lawyers have been debating this for a very long time about this type of investor-state arbitration and to what extent it can be improved or needs to change. The second point that has to do with lex mercatoria, I mean, again, I would say there is no point in debating this with me as a lawyer. If you want to debate this with me over drinks, then I can tell you I just don't think free markets work, because they never have. And so, like, unless we regulate them somehow or bail them out whenever they crash the out of everything, but
okay. Nick, I want you to help and turn us out here.
Yes, thank you. You want me to help him?
I was losing my eloquence in that last year.
If this goes ahead, if there is to be an agreement, and we don't know if it's going to be achieved or not, you don't want ISDS. If there has to be an agreement, how would you have disputes resolved? Perhaps you're going to say there shouldn't be an agreement at all. But if there's going to be an agreement, given that there are large corporations investing, how would you want their disputes with states to be resolved?
Well, first up, definitely we don't think there should be an agreement. But if we're just talking about the ISDS aspect of it. I mean, as far as I see, they can be resolved in the same way everybody else's disputes in society can be resolved. And this is really the core of it for me. I mean, you can make a better or worse, a fairer or slightly, you know, less fair system, but ultimately I simply don't see why investors have special access to a legal mechanism to fulfill their so-called rights. I just don't see why that's acceptable. And certainly, I mean, you can argue, well, at the beginning, you know, we know they were set up, and Antonius is quite right about this, by the way, they were set up at the beginning as empires were falling away, and we no longer had direct control of those countries anymore, so we wanted to protect our investment interests in those countries, so it does come out of empire directly. But I mean, even if you can argue at that time there was some rationale, however much we may disagree with that rationale, you know, when you're talking about two mature democracies, I really have no idea whatsoever why we would give corporations special access that ordinary people do not have to fulfill their okay. their rights and privileges.
Ali, I think you're going to respond to that one. Hold the microphone very close.
Sorry. Okay. I mean, a couple of points there. It is rather grating on someone who represents the people that I represent are directors of SMEs, and so it really sort of grates a little bit to hear the repeated reference to corporations and corporations and corporations. On ISDS, I mean, what is it? There seems to be this sort of intimation that ISDS is an example of an extrajudicial system that is unique in its existence, and we delegate a lot of supranational jurisdiction to European Court of Human Rights, etc. I don't understand why an investor should not have rights, but individuals should have rights. To me, it almost seems like a mutually exclusive.
Investors have rights as individuals or corporations under the European Convention of Human Rights. They just want more.
So, for example,
if you want to sue for expropriation within any Council of Europe state, you can. There is Article 1 of the first additional protocol. It talks about your right to property. Go to the European Court of Human
right.
Rights.
Yeah, but it does not give you a right against discrimination. It does not guarantee that right. That is what happens.
The European Convention doesn't give you a right against discrimination.
No, but Antonius, the point about the Human Rights Convention is you're not going to get damages, large damages.
No, you're going
to
get
Human Rights Court.
You're going to get just satisfaction.
Yeah, just satisfaction doesn't mean you get your money back.
Good, much better. You get just what you get.
Ali,
Someone said to me that investors should just be able to insure their investments. I would love to know an investment, an insurance company that's going to underwrite some of the kind of investments people make into, whether it's into energy development, etc. No one would insure those claims.
There is insurance on the markets, and in any case, surely no one's arguing that someone's not going to invest in the United States because they don't have special access to arbitration. It's just rubbish.
Jacqueline, you take the microphone and respond to that one.
The European Convention on Human Rights does not apply in the United States, and there is, as
it applies to a company that is established in Europe and does work in Europe.
We're talking about a two-way process. And in the US, there is no principle which would prevent a US state authority or US local authority or even the federal authority from discriminating against a foreign investor. Now, you might say, well, perhaps there ought to be a principle, and perhaps that could be found by the normal courts of the US, but so far it hasn't been. And if you look at other partners with the US, they have sought ISDS clauses. So Canada has sought an ISDS clause. Japan is seeking an ISDS clause. They take the view that however mature the democracy, however well established the rule of law, and I think, you know, we know what we mean by the rule of law, which does not mean the rule of bad law. We mean an established body of rights which guarantees certain fundamental rights to individuals, which prevents against discrimination, which prevents against arbitrary action. It's a phrase which sums up what we mean when we talk about respect for the rule of law. So you can say two mature democracies, but the question is whether they would always guarantee the protection of an investment. If, by the way, what I hear from lawyers is, in most cases, they would prefer to pursue a claim through the national courts of either the member states of the European Union or the states of the US, Why? Because the range of remedies that you will get from a normal court is far wider. You can get an injunction, you can get damages, you can get all sorts of remedy that are not available through ISDS. ISDS, the only remedy you will get is a financial one, a monetary one. So it doesn't close off the option of using the normal court system, an ISDS clause. And indeed, again, one of the proposals that the Commission is looking at is what's called the fork in the road, or the exhaustion of rights before the normal national judicial order. So either you first say to a company, you have to sue in the normal national courts, and it's only if your remedy is frustrated by those courts, or you find that you don't have locus standi or no defendable claim, can you turn to ISDS.
But what if you actually simply sue and lose? I mean, you will then...
Oh, no, well, then that's it.
And if you say, but if you say that the local court is biased, then you would say that you lost unfairly, because and then you've lost your chance to ISDS.
Well, what they say is a fork in the road. You know, there comes a point where you have to choose whether to pursue or not.
Another question. There's a gentleman there with his hand up. That's you, sir, with your pen up. Yeah, you do. You're asking a question. The microphone is just coming to you. Do you want to say who you are? And I'll take one.
Thank you, Frank Arnold. Possibly a very stupid question, because I'm not a lawyer, but simply this: there's been a great deal of disquiet about various arrangements for example, tax and other support issues for various large American corporations in Europe. Let us suppose that, for example, the Luxembourg government decides to change its arrangements with one of these giants. Are they then, perhaps under pressure from other states in the EU, are they then liable for suit under the provisions of TTIP, or potential provisions, or can you, and this is directed to Jacqueline Miner, guarantee that this will not happen?
Jacqueline, do you want to take the microphone and respond to that? Just restate the question again for the benefit of those who are not familiar with the background.
I had some difficulty hearing it, but what I understood was that there are already established companies in the European Union who are subsidiaries of American parents. Could we name them? I guess we could name them. Amazon, Google, etc. Who have come in recently for a certain amount of criticism as a result of arranging their tax affairs so as to pay as little as possible in tax, in corporate tax. Would they be subject to, or would they be able to bring an ISDS clause? My answer to that is no, they wouldn't, in my interpretation of existing law and in my supposition as to what the ISDS clause, were it to be included in TTIP, would say. But it's speculation, because we don't know whether there will be an ISDS clause and we don't know exactly the form it will take. But the intention of the European Commission is precisely to enable the governments of the European Union, or the European Union as a supranational regulator, to take the kinds of decision that would prevent tax avoidance of that kind. And by the way, we have published a package of measures today, and they would protect that regulatory space.
Okay, you've got a clear answer there. Yeah, go ahead, Ali.
I think sometimes we fall into the danger of conflating whether someone brings a claim with being a function of actual ISS in of itself. So actually the case that Nick referred to in Slovakia and the government taking ownership of single payment insurance services, the claim was brought under, I can't remember exactly who it was, under a bilateral investment treaty, I want to say, with the Czech Republic, I can't remember exactly, by this company. And the arbitration tribunal ruled that did not have, this did not count, this was not something that it could rule on effectively. So It's very possible that a lot of these claims that are being brought are dismissed because they don't actually have the grounds on which to rule. So I think that we should be careful in that, because we bring up an example of one time an investor made a claim under X, in a lot of these cases, very often they will say, we do not have the jurisdiction to rule on that.
Can I just make a point on this, which I also think is very important? The other thing that we need to remember is, indeed you're right, and there's a common argument that says, oh, but states mostly win. I'm not sure to what extent that is actually
So I haven't done the empirical research to tell you that they mostly win claims brought against them by investors, but I can give you some anecdotal evidence, and I'm sure Stephen can give far more, but in fact he can't publicly discuss, and I won't discuss the name, but I have seen cases which are utterly ridiculous, brought by an investor on the off chance of actually getting money. And and to say that the fact that some of these cases are brought on very little basis whatsoever, and this relates back to Stephen's point, in fact, sometimes there's absolutely no investment in the sense that the investor hasn't done, or the presumed investor, hasn't done anything in the whole state. They're just suing them. It's relatively cheap for, considering the potential return, to actually do that is point one. And the other point is you have to understand that it's not every state that can afford to hire Stephen. And what I mean by that is that I have seen arbitrations where the state was going just with whatever dude they can find in their very small legal department who actually has to deal with 1,000 different things. And had on top of this to deal with an investment arbitration. And investment arbitrations, trust me, they are not for the faint-hearted, and they are not for the non-specialist.
Okay, the gentleman there with a question. A microphone may come to you in a moment, and again, if you want to say who you are. Are there any other questions? Because otherwise I think we'll probably, there's a gentleman up there later. Oh, there are several. Okay. Right, sir, go ahead.
I'm Sam O'Neill. I'm a graduate of UCL Laws, 2009. I work in the private sector. As a construction and development manager. I just wanted to make the observation that there's something about the foreign discrimination justification that's being used for ISDS or in support of it that really doesn't ring true. I can't conceive of a situation whereby an investment that would be worth pursuing wouldn't be done by a special purpose vehicle in that jurisdiction. It just... It sounds completely implausible to me, and I'm really trying to think of other situations in which you would want to pursue that. I just kind of want to...
Okay, thank you.
In fact, there have been very few cases where somebody has won on non-discrimination purposes. Most of the arguments, they will bring non-discrimination arguments under national treatment or most favored nation treatment, but mostly what investors win on when they win is either on expropriation or mostly on fair and equitable treatment.
Okay, I was going to bring the lady who immediately behind the questioner who asked the last question. Go ahead, do you want to say who you are?
Hi there. Obviously, as Jacqueline was saying, things are very much still in progress, but if we accept that there's a strong possibility that there will be an ISDS clause, what would the panel think of the possibility of actually considering that it's cause for treaty change in the EU?
Did you say calls for treaty change?
Well, the possibility that it should give rise to treaty change.
What kind of treaty change are you talking about?
As in
being written into the founding treaties of the EU.
Right. So.
And therefore, obviously, needing ratification by all member states.
But, I see. Okay. Jacqueline, do you want to deal with that?
Well, I think the answer is. Precedent suggests it's not a treaty change because we have ISDS clauses in existing bilateral treaties. So we're not doing anything that we haven't previously done. It's quite interesting that the TTIP, perhaps because it involves the US as a partner, has suddenly woken people up to the issues which trade policy engenders. And I'm not suggesting that they're not legitimate concerns, or the debate isn't one that ought to be had fully and fairly. But these clauses have been in earlier treaties, so they did not then, and some of those treaties were subject to a preliminary opinion of the European Court of Justice, which certified that they were compatible with the treaties, so that it doesn't require treaty change.
All right, gentleman over there with the microphone.
Is that Steve Lauber? I'm sort of a bit perplexed. Jackie, as I understood you to say, said, look, don't worry, from the Commission's perspective, none of this TTIP is going to affect decisions by states in relation to social policy. And I assume by that you also meant that if states made social policy decisions to do something, they could do that without paying large quantities of, or without paying any compensation. Nick, as I understood it, said, gave a number of examples, which obviously don't relate to TTIP because it doesn't apply, but in similar contexts, where states were being ordered to pay large quantities of compensation. And I'm just wondering which is right. And sort of as a second part of that, I don't know if this is right, but it just seemed to me that the ISDS debate must, and how it evolves, must turn quite considerably on this issue of social policy, because obviously, I mean, it seems to me to be objectionable for private arbitration to be effectively determining social policy. If social policy is off the table, and what we're talking about is tariffs on screws or hoovers, then maybe we don't care so much.
Okay, Jackie, it'll be you to answer, and then there's a gentleman over here for the last question, but Jacqueline, go ahead.
Okay, I think that your question raises a number of points. First of all, there is an area which will be excluded from the TTIP, as it has been from all bilateral treaties, and that is policy in relation to the supply of services of general interest, education, health, publicly funded services. They're outside the TTIP. ISDS does not apply to them.
While they're public,
exactly. So, now, if you have a government, and we might have such a government, that chooses to privatise services which are currently publicly funded, can that, a subsequent government that takes a different view, bring back that service into public ownership? The answer is yes, they can, but under national law, they would be subject to a rule about paying fair compensation. You could not suspend a contract. You would either have to, for example, if we take the privatized elements of the NHS now, although this would not be covered by TTIP, as I've already said, if a government decided to take back into public funding and public management those services, they have two choices. Either they wait for the contract to expire and they don't renew it, or they break the contract and they pay compensation for breaking the contract under the normal rules of contract law in this country. For a decision, another decision which fell within TTIP, for example, a decision to change environmental norms, a decision to change the rules governing employment protection, the European Commission has made it clear that the rules about fair and equitable would enable it to do that. If it makes a change of public policy, that regulatory space is preserved for member states and for the European Union.
Okay, listen, I don't think I'm going to have time to call you because I've got 3 minutes to 8 o'clock. I'm going to ask the panel one question, and I would like a one-word answer, or possibly, at the very most, a one-sentence answer. And the question is there going to be a deal? And I think I'll take the panel in reverse order of speaking. So, Nick, is there going to be a TTIP?
Depends how active everybody gets to try and stop it, but we've done pretty well in the first year.
Okay, Ali? Antonius?
Yes, there is going to be a deal. Because that's how the cookie crumbles.
Okay, and Jacqueline?
Yes.
Good, okay, thank you very much indeed. Mike is going to have a last word, I think, and thank the panel.
Very short word, just to thank our panelists very much for coming along, and to Joshua for moderating this. The only other announcement is a much more prosaic one, which is the refreshments across the road in a reception area that if you follow someone, you'll find. That's as much as I've got to say. But again, thank you very much for coming. And again, thank you to the people on the panel and Joshua.